Good morning. Welcome to worship at and with Trinity Lutheran Church on Reformation Sunday. Please don't adjust your television set. Everything is red. We are a Reconciling in Christ congregation of the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America that welcomes all of God's children to form a community of faith that works for racial equity and economic justice and honors the full spectrum of gender, gender identity, and sexual orientation. If you're watching the live stream, you are welcome to receive the sacrament of Holy Communion when you see it received here in the sanctuary. Everyone in the sanctuary is welcome to receive the sacrament. Today, you don't need to be a member of this church or of any church if you want to come to God's table. You have the option of staying in your seats when it's time to receive communion or of coming up to the altar rail. If you're staying where you are, you need the white paper bag that contains the bread and wine or bread and juice that you will receive. And if you come up to the rail, you need to stop at one of these two tables to get the bread and wine or bread and juice, which is clearly marked with a red label. And if you aren't used to these things, the bread is on one side, the liquid is on the other. So liquid side down to begin with. Tends to keep your fingers cleaner. There are a few ways that you can tell us you're here for worship today. Were the kiosks finally working? I don't know, but there were kiosks out there. And there's a QR code on the back page of the bulletin next to a form that I think you can still fill out with a pen if that's your jam. All of these will also let you request regular emails from the church about our activities and events. If you want to have someone mentioned in today's prayers, you need to go to the table at the back of the middle aisle and write their name on one of the post-it notes, and those notes will be collected before we offer today's prayers to the people. I'm sad. I'm also joyful to say that Pastor Preet Rabain died this past week. He was a pastor of this congregation for quite a few years. He was the one who was about 7 feet tall, not the one who was about 4 feet tall. As soon as I hear about his memorial service, I will let you know. Please remember we are collecting jackets and windbreakers and light coats and all of that sort of thing to give out to our neighbors who are going to be struggling with the cold in just a few weeks. So clean out your closets or hit a thrift store and see what you can find. Every Wednesday at 9, a group from the congregation gathers for breakfast at the Copper Kitchen on Central Avenue at 56th Street South. On Wednesdays at 11:30, we offer a free hot meal to the community, and we always need volunteers to help serve it, so talk to Jerry today if you would like to do that. Boy, Wednesday is the big day at Trinity now, because at 3 and at 7 on Wednesdays, unless someone suggests a better time to the pastor, we are going to offer an online class on the subject of prayer. We're going to start by meeting for 8 sessions, and then we'll decide if we want to do more in the new year. This week, we'll just get together to talk about what prayer is and what we hope to accomplish with it. Wednesday, 3 or 7, on Zoom. If you don't know how to access our Zoom stuff, call the church office. The food pantry is open on Friday mornings. Not Wednesdays? Fridays? Really? Everything else is on Wednesday at Trinity. Well, not true. Okay, the food pantry is open on Friday mornings, and we always need volunteers there at 9. Talk to Lynn. She's the one wearing red. Next Sunday, during fellowship time, we will be celebrating Thankstoberfest. And that will include all the food and drink that you can imagine in that combination of words. Thankstoberfest. So plan to stay after church for that. Are there any other announcements that need to be made today? This congregation can't exist without the generous financial gifts of our worshipers. There is an offering plate out there in the narthex, the entrance area of the church, where you can put donations, or you can use a smartphone and the QR code on page 6 of your bulletin to make a contribution on our website. Is there anyone with us in worship today that is celebrating a birthday or an anniversary this week? All right, then I will invite you to silence those cell phones and quiet your heart and mind to get ready for worship today.
As you're able to do so, and as it's easy to do so, I invite you to stand and face us here at the baptismal font. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose love is unconditional and eternal. Amen. Together, let us acknowledge our failure to love this world as Jesus does. God of mercy and truth, we confess that sin still has a hold on us. We have harmed your good creation. We have failed to do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with you. Turn us in a new direction. Show us a path that leads to life. Be our refuge and strength. Beloved of God, in Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven and you are made whole. Continue your journey in love and hope through the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you. The first reading is from the book of Jeremiah. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant that I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, a covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer shall they teach one another or say to each other, Know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity and remember their sin no more. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Second reading is from Romans. Now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be silenced and the whole world may be held accountable to God. For no human being will be justified in his sight by deeds prescribed by the law, for through the law comes the knowledge of sin. But now, apart from law, the righteousness of God has been disclosed and is attested by the law and the prophets, the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. For there is no distinction, since all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. They are now justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a sacrifice of atonement by his blood, effective through faith. He did this to show his righteousness, because in his divine forbearance, he had passed over the sins previously committed. It was to prove at the present time that he himself is righteous and that he justifies the one who has faith in Jesus. Then what becomes of boasting? It is excluded. By what law? By that of works? No, but by the law of faith. For we hold that a person is justified by faith apart from the works prescribed by the law. Amen. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Continue in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free. They answered him, "We are descendants of Abraham and have never been slaves to anyone. What do you mean by saying you will be made free?" Jesus answered them, "Very truly, I tell you, everyone who commits sin is a slave to sin. The slave does not have a permanent place in the household. The son has a place there forever. So if the son makes you free, you will be free indeed." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Do I need to do this?
I don't know where. How's that?
Now I have to try and stay within its field of vision. Sorry. This is the important stuff of church in the 21st century. Tomorrow is the 505th anniversary of an event that transformed the Christian church. On that day in 1517, a notice was hung on the door of a church in the college town of Wittenberg, Germany. It read in part, "Out of love for the truth, the Reverend Father Martin Luther, Master of Arts in Sacred Theology and lecturer therein at Wittenberg, intends to defend the following statements and to dispute on them in that place. He followed this with 95 statements about the Christian faith that he believed to be true, the first being that Jesus intended the entire life of a Christian to be a life of repentance. Repentance. Turning away from the world's values and reorienting ourselves to God's values, repentance is an ongoing process, both because we stray from our original intentions and because we find more and more of ourselves in need of reorientation and repentance. Martin Luther inadvertently started his reformation of the church out of love for the truth. Similarly, if we want to know the truth so that it can set us free, Jesus says that just believing in him isn't enough, because belief can so easily be led astray. To keep ourselves oriented toward the ways of God, Jesus says we need to continue, to remain, to abide in his word, in his personal revelation of the self-sacrificing love of God. Like the people to whom Jesus spoke these words, we may have an incomplete understanding of the word freedom, connecting it to our nationality, our race, or our history. We might connect our freedom to politics or to economics, seeing freedom as the ability to do as we wish, when we wish, and solely because we wish, not realizing that our wishes and our desires are often enslaved to compulsions that we cannot control. When the letter to the Romans talks about the law, it isn't just talking about the law given to the Jewish people in the Old Testament. It also refers to the natural laws that govern the world, the laws that make any person of any nation, culture, or religion aware that we live in relationship with one another and with the planet itself. It is through the laws of nature, as much as through the Ten Commandments, that we become aware of how much we sin against God, against one another, and against creation itself. And we're seeing evidence of that more and more. Through the law comes the knowledge of sin. The law helps us to know how much we are in need of God's help. And it is separate from all of these laws that the power of God and the love of God are revealed in God's desire to save us from our slavery to sin. While the Apostle Paul saw the Old Testament law as a precious gift to the Jewish people, he knew it was only intended for them and not for any other cultural group. All people, regardless of their race, religion, or nationality, come into a right relationship with God, not because of their obedience to any laws, but solely because of God's love. God's righteousness is disclosed as God's righteousness is just given to us and placed within our hearts and minds as a gift. God's righteousness isn't some standard that we have to try and live up to. It has already been placed within us. The death and resurrection of Jesus can heal all of the broken relationships in the world. That is what is meant by it being a sacrifice of atonement. It isn't about paying anyone's penalty. It's about healing people from the inside out, making them one with God and one with each other. Only God can transform the very core of our being so that we can be free of compulsion, free of fear, and free of shame. Set free from these chains, we are then free to live as we were created to live, for the sake of one another, and not only for the sake of ourselves and our needs. We are free to live as if God's truth was written on our heart. We then know the truth that is divine love. We live and move and have our being in that love. Today's reading from Romans emphasizes the word now again and again. God is always acting in the now and not just in the past. God is always reforming the church so that it can address the problems that we face now. The letter to the Romans was written to heal broken relationships. It can also be used to heal relationships between men and women and people who don't think gender is just a box to be checked on a form. The death and resurrection of Jesus can heal relationships between races, even in a nation as tormented as ours. God's self-sacrificing love is the only power strong enough to do this. That is the message of Luther's famous hymn, "A Mighty Fortress Is Our God," which is based upon Psalm 46, although that might be hard to recognize, because while the psalm celebrates God's power over the chaotic forces of nature, waters that rage and foam, and God's power over all political forces, nations, and kingdoms, Luther's hymn shifts that focus to God's protection of us in a battle against the forces of evil in the world. He once wrote that we sing this psalm to the praise of God because God is with us and powerfully and miraculously preserves and defends God's church and God's word against all fanatical spirits, against the gates of hell, against the implacable hatred of the devil, and against all the assaults of the world, the flesh, and sin. Into every age and in every generation, people of faith are attacked by forces that want to crush and divide human beings. In 2022, we are fighting against two pandemics, one of a virus and one of hatred, violence, and fear-mongering. Acts of violence and hatred against blacks, against Jews, against refugees, against transgender people, they're all on the rise. The sad fact of human sinfulness is that when we are given permission and even encouraged to hate some of our brothers and sisters in the human family, we are quick to do it. Where do we find the faith to say, we will not fear though the earth be moved? Where do we find the courage to stand against the forces that want to move us in the direction of evil and sin? Psalm 46 is completely non-violent. God is the one who eliminates our desire for violence and destroys our weapons of war. The command to be still is directed at the warring factions of the world. Luther's hymn is also nonviolent. I really wish the old words, a bulwark never failing, hadn't been changed to a sword and shield victorious. Do we have time to switch to it back?
No.
Well. The original German, Janet, describes a castle that is secure and sturdy, offering defense and protection, rather than inflicting any harm on anyone other than our old satanic foe. The church needs to be a place of refuge from the hatred and violence of our society. A place where we continue to honor one another as children of God, even when we disagree or struggle to reach a consensus. So when you sing A Mighty Fortress today, and you will, sing it in defiance of the coronavirus. Sing it in defiance of racism and sexism and every other fear of some other. Sing it in defiance of the messages of hatred, anger, and fear that come screaming out of the television. Claim the promise that we have received our freedom, and that no matter what happens to us in the course of our lives, the kingdom of God is ours forever. Amen. Don't make me go down. Using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. In gratitude and in humility, let us join together in prayer on behalf of all of God's creation.
God, our fortress, we pray for the church. Write your law of love on our hearts, that we remain steadfast in our witness to your grace. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God, our liberator, we pray for your earth. Reform and reorient our relationship with the environment, that we faithfully care for all of your creation. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God, our refuge and strength, we pray for the nations. Where they are in an uproar, bring wise leadership and comfort for those in distress, that wars may cease and peace come to every land. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God, our very present help in trouble, we pray for those in need, especially the congregation of St. Peter's Lutheran in Fort Myers Beach, Virginia Rooker, Melody, Lois Tackett, Diane and Phil Hinton, Ann Stefankowicz, Helen Hauser, Mark Mendehall, Olivia Jackson, Terry Greenlaw, Missy and John Gozel, Kim Snyder, and all those we bring before you now. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God, our Redeemer, we pray for this congregation. Open our hearts to your Holy Spirit. Teach us your word, and give us courage to proclaim our trust in you. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God, our stronghold, we give thanks for Preet Rabane, Nancy Way, and for all who have gone before us in faith. Renew and reform us as we follow their example and continue in your word. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
With grateful hearts, we commend our spoken and silent prayers to you, O God. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Find ways to share signs of that peace with one another. 21st century. As you're able to do so, as it's easy to do so, please stand and join me in offering the offering prayer that is printed in the bulletin. Gracious God, in your great love, you richly provide for our needs. Make of these gifts a banquet of blessing, and make us ready to share with all in need. Through Jesus Christ, who sets a table for all. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
Who preached good news to the poor, and who on the cross opened his arms to all. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all who share this heavenly food, the body and blood of Jesus Christ, our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray the words that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Christ invites you to this table. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Amen. Please be seated. The ushers will tell you when to come forward for communion, if that's what you're planning to do. If you're going to stay where you are, get out that little kit. Hold it with the liquid side down and peel the cover on top. It is the body of Christ given for you. Turn the kit over, peel the cover on the other side. It is the blood of Christ shed for you.
The body
God of the abundant table, you have refreshed our hearts in this meal with bread for the journey. Give us your grace on the road, that we might serve our neighbors with joy, for the sake of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. As you're able to do so, and as it's easy to do so, I invite you to stand to receive God's blessing. God, who gives life to all things and frees us from despair, bless you with truth and peace. And may the Holy Trinity, one God, guide you always in faith, hope, and love.
Thanks be to God.